Do I have a pointer or? Okay. Okay, so the goal of this project was to tackle symbolic regression using the physics-inspired methods. So the paper appeared on archive yesterday, actually. So symbolic regression represents the task of finding a symbolic expression that matches data from unknown functions. And throughout the history, this proved to be a useful task for developing physics. For example, it's what allowed Kepler to discover the fact that planets move in elliptical orbits around the sun. However, this took Kepler 4 years to discover, so the goal is to try to accelerate this process and make it automatic. So of course, one can try to use a brute force method to find a solution, basically trying all the combination of the allowed mathematical symbols and variables. However, even if you are using an effective notation, such as the reverse Polish notation, the search space grows exponentially with the number of symbols. So even for a one variable function, the search time can take a few years. For a three variables function, this can go up to 1 million years. And for even more complicated functions, using this approach can take significantly longer than the age of the universe. So previous approaches to tackle this problem use genetic algorithms, and Eureka is the best available software that implements this method, and the software that uses as a comparison with our algorithm. However, we don't use genetic algorithms. Instead, we take advantage of the properties of function of physical interest, such as symmetry, separability, the fact that variables have units, and we try to break the functions apart into smaller parts and solve each one independently, and then combine everything at the end in order to discover the function. So for this, we picked 100 algebraic equations from the Feynman lectures in physics to test the performance of our algorithm. So here are some of the functions that we have. So for each function, we generate generate data for each variable, and we compute the value of the function at these data points. We pass the data to our algorithm, and the goal of the algorithm is to discover the function that generated that data set. So here's how we pass the data. So we have the initial data, which in this case has three independent variables, and the last column is the value of the function evaluated at these data points. So the goal of our algorithm is to try to find patterns in this data and break it apart into smaller data sets that can then be solved one by one independently and then combined at the end. So the main methods that we use for these algorithms are dimensional analysis. Then we have brute force and polynomial fit for actually finding the equations. We also train a neural network whose goal is to find patterns in the data, searching for things like symmetry, for example, translational symmetry, separability, the effect of making two variables equal. And we also apply several unary transformations to the variables, such as taking the square root or exponentiating the value of the function. So here is the flow of our algorithm, and I'm going to go through the main components of it. So dimensional analysis simply takes advantage of the fact that variables in physics have units. So we associate to each variable of five-dimensional vectors in terms of the fundamental SI units. And for each equation, we build a matrix out of this vector. So each column in that matrix has a vector corresponding to a given variable in that equation. Then we build a null space of that matrix, and from there we can extract dimensionless variable. And the number of variables in the newly created equation is equal to the null space of the to the dimension of the null space, so it's significantly lower than the initial number of variables. Then we train a fully connected neural network able to predict the output of a function given its input. So here are the main parameters, and after 100 epochs, we reach an RMSE loss between 10 to the minus 3 and 10 to the minus 5 for these 100 equations. So the first thing that we do with this neural network is to search for symmetries. So basically, given a function of n variable, we calculate the value of the same function, where in this case, the first two variables, x1 and x2, are replaced with x1 plus a and x2 plus a, or where a is a constant. And we can do this for any pair of two variables. And if the function evaluated at these two points has the same value to within a precision epsilon given by the neural network error, it means that f depends on x1 and x2 only through their difference. So then we are able to replace these two initial variables, x1 and x2, with their difference. So the newly created function has one less variable than before, and we are able to repeat this process to reduce the number of variables until there are no more translational symmetries to be discovered. And we do the same for the sum, product, and ratio of two variables. So for example, in this case, we can x minus x and mu appear only through their difference, so we can replace them with a new variable which significantly reduces the complexity of this equation. The next thing that we do with a neural network is to check for separability. So basically, we want to see if a given equation can be split into two parts that don't have variables in common. And of course, we can do this for any number of variables, not only two. So if this equation holds, where C1 and C2 are some constants, to within a precision epsilon given again by the neural network, it means that the function is multiplicatively separable. So we're able to define two new variables in terms of the original function and this constant C1 and C2. And then we're trying to find symbolic expression for each of these two new functions and then combine them at the end if we succeed. And we do the same for additive separability. And here is an example where after applying the multiplicative separability, you get a function that contains only phi and a function that contains only n and delta. And this y0 goes away by the dimensional analysis part. So going back to the original algorithm, so the way it works overall, we pass the initial data file with the columns of numbers to our algorithm. It goes through dimensional analysis, polynomial fit, and brute force. And if we are not able to find the function that generated that data, we train the neural network and try to search for several properties of our function. And if we discover anything, for example, separability, we create two new data sets that are simpler than the original data set. And we pass them back into the algorithms and we repeat this process until we either find the equation or we run out of methods to try. So here is an example for one function of nine variables, so the gravitational force formula, which can be solved directly by using brute force. And as you'll see later, it can't be solved by genetic algorithms either. So the first thing that we do, we apply dimensional analysis, which gets this factor out. It has units of force. And these terms can be written in terms of dimensionless variable. So we go from 9 to 6 variable. Then we train a neural network, which is able to find the fact that C minus D and E minus F always appear as differences. So it's able to replace these variables with new one, G and H. So we go from 6 to 4 variables. Then multiplicative separability is able to split this further. So the A part is easily discovered by the brute force method. And then we have this term, which still can be solved. But we also have some unary transformation that I mentioned earlier. So by inverting this function, we bring it into the form of a polynomial, which then can be easily solved by the polynomial fit method. So once we reach this end, we go backwards and we put all the pieces back. We combine the pieces together and we're able to retrieve the function that generated our initial data. So doing so, we are able to solve all the 100 equations that we picked from the Feynman lecture with a reasonable run times between 10 seconds and 2 hours, while the genetic algorithm-based software, Eureka, was able to solve only 71 of these equations. And if you look at some of the equations that we solved and Eureka didn't solve, you can see that they have all these kind of properties that our neural network was able to take advantage of, reflecting the power of this tool compared to classical genetic algorithms methods. We also checked the effect of adding Gaussian noise with the start-on deviation of epsilon times YRMS, where YRMS is the RMS of the value of the function before adding noise. So with an epsilon of 10 to the minus 4, we're able to solve almost all the equations. And even with a percentage level noise, we're still able to solve 40% of the equations. Then we check the effect of reducing data. So with 10 data points, we're able to solve 82% of the equations. And with 100 data points, we're still able to solve 95%. Of course, for a complicated equation that required a neural network, we needed more data points. But even in that case, some of them were solvable with only 100 or 1,000 data points only. Then we check the effect of removing the dimensional analysis on our code. And in that case, we are still able to solve 93% of the equations. And here are some of those that we are still able to solve after removing dimensional analysis. So in this case, the usefulness of the neural network is even greater. So for example, in this case, when we are having dimensional analysis, H omega would be factored out. But in this case, the neural network is still able to discover the fact that H omega appear always together, and same for KT. So the neural network in two steps is able to reduce this problem from a 4 variables to a 2 variable problem that can be solved later using a brute force method. And these are some of those equations that we're not able to solve after removing the dimensional analysis. And as you can see, there are functions that don't have any interesting properties, such as separability or symmetries. So the neural network couldn't break them into smaller parts, and the brute force alone was not able to solve them in a reasonable amount of time. So this shows that the neural network is a powerful tool even in the absence of dimensional analysis, but dimensional analysis is still useful for the cases where the function don't have interesting properties that the neural network can take advantage of. So you can think of this 100 equation that we had before as a training set because it allowed us to fix all the hyperparameters. And then we picked 20 more equations as a test set. So we picked them based on the fact that they were either famous, either from famous textbooks such as Weinberg or Jackson. And we ran our code on this with the hyperparameters that were set from before. So in this case, we were able to solve 18 out of these 20 equations. And these are the two ones that we didn't solve. So the problem with the first one is this power of 5, which gives huge variation of the function for small variation in the parameters. And the neural network is not able to learn this function properly. So it's not able to discover the separability of these functions. And the problem here is this 4 pi epsilon, which doesn't cancel out. And even if it looks simpler, when it's written in the reverse Polish notation, it requires lots of symbols, so the search time gets very big. On the other hand, Eureka was able to solve only these 3 equations out of these 20. So there are things that we can do to improve the to improve our algorithm. So we didn't really fine-tune our hyperparameters for each equation individually. We had the same hyperparameters for all 120 equations, and doing so will definitely give better result. We can also add the genetic algorithms on top of our algorithm, which might work better in the case where you have a high amount of noise. We can also try to use natural units for some equation, which might solve this 4 pi epsilon problem. We can also add new symbols to our brute force code, for example, a power symbol or a square symbol, which might simplify the problem in the case of these high powers equations. We can also try to search for other properties of the function, such as rotational symmetry. And we can also include other two variable combinations, not only difference and sums, the way we had so far. So in conclusion, we took advantage of the properties of function of practical interest to build a new algorithm for symbolic regression. And using dimensional analysis and neural networks to search for patterns in this function, we were able to break them apart into smaller pieces that allowed us to find expression for complicated functions. And we were able to obtain significantly better results than the state-of-the-art methods based on genetic algorithms. And the codes was able to give very good results even with a significant amount of noise and with little data. And of course, we look forward for the day that AI will be able to discover a new physics equation. Thank you.